no longer directly. I keep introductions short. One reason is that the first keynote speaker will just cover the same slides but speak faster if I use a long time in introduction. It's a pleasure to introduce Professor Enrique Iglesias. He's worked at Exxon for I won't say how many years and now has moved to California where he's the Chemical Engineering Department of the University of California, Berkeley.
Good afternoon. The first speaker also has a reputation for speaking fast anyway. So imagine what happens if there were to be a long introduction. I'd like to thank the organizers for the opportunity to be here. And after several tries for finally making it to West Virginia, I'm going to talk today about catalytic properties of metal oxides. And in particular, I'm going to try to tie together two things that most people would normally not tie together, and that is the acidic properties and the redox properties of metal oxides. The way that I'm going to try to do that is by choosing two examples from our work. One of the examples will be the ability of supported tungsten oxide clusters, and I'm going to use the term cluster with some trepidation, and specifically the properties that they have for acid catalyzed reactions. As you evolve surface structures throughout the range from isolated species to polytungstates and finally to three-dimensional structures, you get acidity in these materials that changes rather dramatically. And I point out that it is acidity which is of the Bronsted type in spite of the fact that my cartoon here has no protons anywhere. I'd like to tie that together to a totally different kind of reaction, one that involves by all measures redox type chemistry rather than acid catalysis. And to show you that in both cases, we seem to be able to access both electronic properties and catalytic properties of the material only when we get to an intermediate size and what I'm going to loosely call domain size. I'm going to begin with this example, which is a collaboration with George Meitzer and Stu Solid, and most of the work has been done by Dave Martin in my group. And then I'm going to move on to a project that is much more recent, about 6 months old, that is being done in collaboration with Alex Bell by a postdoc in our group, Andrei Kotakov. Well, the first example had its birth in the pioneering work of Ino and Arata, who in 1987 found out that by a very simple impregnation of a metatungstate species on zirconium oxyhydroxide, followed by a critical oxidation at temperatures that are much higher than where we should take most of our catalytic materials, they saw the rather sudden appearance of catalytic activity for what appeared by all measures to be an acid-catalyzed reaction. The unselective isomerization of normal pentane with a significant formation of the undesired cracking product. This kind of work, I think, lay dormant for many years, both because of this undesirable selectivity and also because the catalyst deactivated very rapidly. Actually, they obtained these measurements by using a pulse reactor, but because they could not really maintain any significant activity for any reasonable period of time. A few years later, we actually solved both of these problems by realizing that in the presence of platinum in this system, to be able to dissociate hydrogen, and most importantly, when hydrogen is present as H2 in the gas phase, we were able to get not only stable activity, but actually a much lower cracking selectivity. This was the beginning of what appeared to be an unusual effect of hydrogen that we then went on to explore. There are two mysteries here. One of them is why a catalyst would have activity only when you pretreat it over such a narrow range of oxidation temperature. And finally, what is this hydrogen effect that appears to have such a significant impact on the activity, stability, and selectivity of these systems? We decided to move away from reactions of alkanes because of the obvious complications and potential bifunctionality, and we decided to look at a very simple acid-catalyzed reaction, a reaction that in theory should involve only the protonation and deprotonation with an intermittent methyl shift, namely the isomerization of both of xylene to give you those two isomers. And we were able to reproduce for a reaction that has no right to either require hydrogen or be affected in any way by hydrogen, a much higher rate of reaction when we carried out the reaction in hydrogen after pretreating the material in hydrogen than when we carried out the reaction in helium after pretreating the material in helium. It appeared that these materials were not very acidic, whenever there was no hydrogen present either during the pretreatment or during the reaction. When we then ran the reaction in hydrogen, we found that we could reproduce the same maximum activity that we have observed in alkane isomerization reactions at about the same temperature, and again, requiring a calcination, an oxygen treatment at a temperature of the order of about 800 degrees or so. First question that I would like to try to answer is why such a sharp maximum in activity, and specifically, what may be the structure of the materials that give rise to that maximum rate? First thing that one tries before any structural characterization is to actually find out whether there's something magical about this temperature. And the way that we did that was to actually make catalyst what we now changed the amount of tungsten that we had in the sample, and then subjected it to the same range of calcination temperatures to see whether the position of that maximum actually changed with temperature or not. When we did that, we get what one usually gets in catalysis. You change anything and everything else changes. What we found was that the blue curve here, which is the one that I showed you previously, actually shifted to lower calcination temperatures required for maximum activity when we increased the amount of tungsten, and shifted to a higher value of that calcination temperature as we decreased the amount of tungsten. Now, what you ought to realize is that this material is not perfectly stable as far as the surface area is concerned. As I increase the calcination temperature, what is going on is that the surface area of the zirconia underneath is shrinking as I go to higher and higher temperatures. And when we saw this, one thought was that perhaps we could explain this effect by realizing that at this calcination temperature, the surface area of the zirconia was higher than it was at this temperature than it was at this temperature. And that the role of the calcination temperature was to take however much tungsten oxide you had in that system and effectively densify, take it away from isolated tungsten species on the surface and get it to crowd together in a way that somehow generated this catalytic activity. The thought was that if we took something as simple-minded as the total amount of tungsten and divided it by the total surface area that we had in each one of those catalysts, that we could define something called the surface density of tungsten, and that that now may become something that universally will be able to define the shape of a new curve, where the hidden variable, the true variable, is actually that surface density rather than the two things that we measure, the tungsten loading and the calcination temperature. And indeed, when we did that, we realized that all of these effects of loading and calcination temperature were hiding underneath the fact that this reaction would like to have an intermediate value of this surface density. One thing that I ought to point out is that the value of that surface density is larger than what would one expect from an equivalent monolayer of polytungstate. In other words, by the time you get to these surface densities, you have to have more than one layer. You have to have three-dimensional structures in this material, and this appeared to be required in order to get this rate to reach its maximum value. This side of the curve is, of course, very simple to explain. If you take something to too high a temperature and you agglomerate, now the accessibility of your surface atoms decreases, and of course, you get a decrease in the rate of the reaction. It was this part of the curve that we really wanted to explain. So the thought was that as we densify, as we sinter the zirconia underneath, we were evolving surface structures that went all the way to inaccessible bulk WO3, but also we started with effectively inactive isolated tungstates on that surface. We had some additional evidence that we were building up three-dimensional structures, and that came from a poor man's surface-sensitive technique. And that is, you take a tungsten oxide on zirconia and you attempt to find out how much of the zirconia is really exposed on the surface by using a titration technique that is sensitive only to the zirconium oxide. In effect, what we're measuring is how much of the surface of zirconia is still available for this selective titration with CO2. What we find is that initially, as we increase that side density, we get a coverage which appears to be almost a one-by-one type titration, as expected if we were building only a two-dimensional layer on the surface. But notice also that in this linear region, there was hardly any catalytic activity. And it was only when we began to flatten out here, when we're effectively now putting tungsten oxide on top of tungsten oxide, that we began to see the appearance of catalytic activity. The building of three-dimensional structures appeared to lead to catalytic behavior that was not available to you when you had isolated tungstate species, as shown by this dotted line, which is where the catalytic activity sets in. Well, the question that one asks now is, what kind of structures do you have here? And moreover, if I look at the materials that have a significant catalytic activity, can I detect any structural differences among the material? Given the fact that there's no X-ray diffraction that is measurable on any of these materials, we went after a local structural technique, one that allows you to measure around a tungsten atom what is its local coordination and hopefully the number of nearest neighbors, although that has proven very difficult to do. The technique that is ideally suited to do this is the observation of the near edge spectrum of around the tungsten L1 edge for a range of materials, beginning with two standard materials that I show here to show you how distinct the near edge features are. In this case, a tetrahedral tungsten oxide has a very pronounced pre-edge feature. It is a dipole forbidden transition in central symmetric structures, but becomes allowed as you distort the symmetry of that octahedral type species. This is what you get for bulk W03, which is not a perfect octahedron, and therefore also has a finite amount of that electronic transition. Of course, if you use this as standard compounds, then the question that you ask, if you look at your catalytic materials, are they isolated tetrahedral structures, or are they bulk like W03? Moreover, is there a change in their structure as you change now this surface density? The results were disappointing, but very educational. What we found was that over the entire range of catalytic activity, we actually had species that looked an awful lot like W03. There were distorted octahedral species that nonetheless were changing something about their electronic or structural properties in order to give rise to that Bronsted acidity. In effect, it told us nothing more than the coordination symmetry was distorted octahedral and W03-like. Again, evidence that we have more than just isolated tungstates on that surface. Well, we wanted to get something that was more quantitative and that which finally gave us some idea about what was changing as you went through that range of surface density. And we noticed, embarrassingly, that what appeared to coincide the best with the catalytic activity was the appearance of a yellowish color in the material. And as a result of it, we decided that perhaps there was something in the UV visible spectrum that was noticeably different as we went through that range of surface density. At about the same time, a little bit earlier actually, Bob Weber had been looking at the effects of domain size on the band gap energies of various semiconductors. And specifically what he noticed was that for the case of molybdenum compounds, there appeared to be a decrease in the band gap approaching those for molybdenum trioxide as you increase the number of nearest neighbors. In other words, as you enlarge the domains, there was what appeared to be a decrease in the band gap. And as you made the domain smaller and isolated the molybdenum, you actually ended up with something that looked like the larger homo-lumo gap that you normally get for molecular type species. When we did the same thing in the case of tungsten oxide standard compounds, what we found was that you get the same directional trend, that as you go from W1 species to W12 species and finally to bulk W03, if you forget about the details and you concentrate on this band gap region here, there was certainly a shift. What we wanted to then probe was whether there was any monotonic change in the electronic spectrum now of those particles as we increase their size, or as we appear to increase their size. Well, if you concentrate on the left-hand side first, what you have here is the same UV visible spectrum as an absorption spectrum for bulk W03, and now for materials that have increasing surface density, the appearance of catalytic activity occurring in samples that have this range of surface density. If we have very low loadings, we have effectively what looks like nearly isolated, not quite, OX type species. As we increase the surface density, we get a gradual shift, suggesting again that we're densifying those structures into larger domains, domains that unfortunately after a while reach something that looks like bulk-like W03 and therefore have very low surface area. But somewhere out here there was the development of what appeared to be almost unimodal size clusters that had a domain size or an electronic structure that resembled a material, the ammonium metatungstate, which was about a W12 type species. And that the range in band gap energy appeared to occur in a range of surface density, what we saw again, the appearance of that catalytic activity. The materials that have intermediate band gap energies and apparently intermediate domain size were able to give you this maximum in activity. Well, this is all fine and good, but I think that we all like to see pictures that the particles are growing. And even though the picture is a little bit difficult to discern from the back, I want you not to concentrate on these particles, which are getting larger as I increase the calcination temperature. Those particles are the zirconia, which is sintering as I increase the calcination temperature. I want you to notice that what you can barely note, which are the distinct clusters that are visible by high-resolution TEM that actually grow in size as we sinter the zirconium oxide underneath, again, in the range of temperature where we see the appearance of catalytic activity and then the disappearance of catalytic activity as you get larger and larger clusters on that surface. This is visual evidence, not that the UV-Vis was not visual, but this is visual evidence that the size of those clusters is increasing as we, underneath, sort of take away the zirconium oxide that is supposed to spread them out on that surface. Well, I have told you, and I hope that you're convinced, that the magical effect of calcination temperature or of site density is actually due to the formation of these clusters of intermediate size. The question then is why? And if we come up with the right answer, we may also be able to explain why hydrogen has such a pronounced effect on the rate of these reactions. In order to do that, I need to take a step back. I need to go back to some of the earliest work that we did in this area when we were working on alkane isomerization and we were working with platinum-containing systems. What we detected at the time was not only a fairly dramatic effect of hydrogen on the rate and selectivity of the reaction, which was unusual for an acid-catalyzed reaction, but we also saw that when we attempted to characterize these materials, we were getting what is normally called hydrogen spillover. In other words, that if we tried to measure the amount of carbon monoxide that was absorbed on the material, we got a value that should be reflective of the dispersion of the platinum on the surface of that tungstated zirconium. But when we used the other commonly used titrate for platinum, namely hydrogen, we got a significantly larger amount. This was sort of evidence that we were spilling hydrogen onto the support, and it suggested to us that what would otherwise have been a neutral tungsten oxide cluster, a cluster that had no right to have any Brønsted acidity because there are no hydrogens anywhere, was able to acquire hydrogen by taking H2 from the gas phase, having a platinum to dissociate it, and then spill over onto the support. Well, the next question is this hydrogen acidic? It appears to be, because the rate of the reaction was proportional to the amount of hydrogen that we put in the gas phase, but actually the evidence came directly for a system that is related in behavior, but has a different composition. That is the sulfate of zirconia system. The work of Hattori actually showed that if you measure the number of Brønsted acid sites by a titration of a molecule that allows you to distinguish between the Brønsted and the Lewis acid sites, as you increase the hydrogen exposure temperature, there appears to be an increase in the density of those sites. This shows that on this system, the hydrogen goes onto the support. This one shows that in this other system, the hydrogen is indeed acidic. Well, if the hydrogen that goes onto the support is indeed acidic, there must be something that is changing about the redox properties of that tungsten oxide. In other words, if I take a hydrogen that I have dissociated on a platinum side and I put it onto this tungsten oxide in this case, how do I acquire Brønsted acidity? One possibility is that you do it by effectively introducing a color center, forming a tungsten bronze, or perhaps bringing a hydrogen electron pair into a tungsten oxide cluster, letting the electron occupy mostly the available orbitals in the tungsten oxide, and at least when you stretch that bond to do chemistry, get what appears to be a proton rather than a hydrogen radical. Since we appear to also be able to use the eye to show what the effect of hydrogen was, we decided to look now at the pre-edge features that we had in the UV visible spectrum. This is where the color centers generally appear. This is where most people will go and look for the existence of bronzes. And what we did was we looked at the reflectance spectrum now in the UV-Vis, and as a function of time in the presence of hydrogen in the gas phase, we saw changes. Changes that suggested that indeed the tungsten oxide that was giving rise to this edge right here was actually changing in structure as a result of the presence of hydrogen. When we looked at the rate at which this occurred, we actually found that if we plot the rate of formation of these color centers, it appeared to increase as we increase the surface density. In other words, it became easier to be able to generate these color centers. It became easier to stabilize hydrogen as we make the clusters larger and larger, and then it appeared to continue to be easier as you went to bulk WO3. Now, mind you, that on this side of it, remember, we're losing surface area. So the ability to stabilize those core centers does not necessarily lead to catalytic activity because many of them are not going to be accessible to the reactants in the case of bulk WO3. So it appeared that there was an increase in the ability to reduce this tungsten oxide and generate these core centers as we went higher and higher in surface density, in this case by increasing the temperature of oxidation. And finally, we said, why don't we try to measure, actually, the amount of hydrogen that goes on now. Now, remember, there's no platinum here, so there's no way to really easily dissociate hydrogen, and as a result, the rate of dissociation is quite slow. But nonetheless, if we do an equilibrium measurement in which we measure the amount of hydrogen per tungsten that we're able to stabilize as we increase the surface density here, we see that there is a loose correlation between the surface density at which activity forms and the appearance of this hydrogen on the sample. Now, the rate of xylene isomerization, which I show here, is about an order of magnitude higher than what one gets on zeolites, in spite of the fact that apparently the number of active sites is only a very small fraction of the number of tungsten atoms that you have there. So whatever these sites may be, they have a very unique and very high turnover rate for a very simple reaction, a reaction that in most cases does not require particularly strong acidity. Now, we also wanted to get direct evidence that the hydrogen was playing a role in the generation of acid sites during the reaction. And if you recall this data, this material was treated in hydrogen and then run in hydrogen. This material was treated in helium and then was run in helium. What happens if you reverse those two? In other words, what happens if you do a treatment in hydrogen to predetermine the number of protons and then you put it on the reaction? And what happens if you do a treatment in helium so that you don't preset that number and then you run the reaction in hydrogen? This is what you get. First of all, if we look at the blue line, the blue curve right here, this is the case in which we have set the number of acid sites initially by doing a hydrogen pretreatment, but during the reaction, the microscopic reverse of that process begins to desorb the hydrogen, and as a result of it, the activity goes down to levels that begin to resemble what we had there when we did not have hydrogen. On the other hand, if we take a sample where we treat in helium and therefore there is no initial hydrogen in the sample, and we carry out the reaction now in hydrogen, the hydrogen, within a certain characteristic time, begins to now introduce itself into the surface. The surface realizes with some delay that there's hydrogen in the gas phase, and activity increases. The time scales that we're talking about here are the same in both directions, and moreover, they're similar to the rate at which deuterium will exchange with xylene at reaction conditions. The hydrogen is playing a role of generating acid sites during pretreatment, but it is needed to be maintained there in order to maintain those acid sites. Now, we think of the system in the following way. There's hydrogen in the gas phase. There is a magical dissociation site, which in the case of platinum is very easy to find. In the case of tungsten oxide, may depend on things that we don't quite understand. But after hydrogen is dissociated, what happens is intermediate-sized clusters are able to accommodate what appears to be a small net negative charge that makes, for all practical purposes, a hydrogen that looks like a hydroxyl group become acidic. Acidic because when you insist on stretching that bond and you have to make a decision where the electron stays, it tends to stay behind on a very stable conjugate base. The acidity is generated by redox chemistry, which is particularly facile and most effective when we have intermediate-sized clusters. What I'd like to do with a second example is to do it a little bit more quickly with less detail, but I would like to complicate it a little bit. I could have given you a second part of the talk on just vanadium oxide on zirconium. I'm going to make it more complicated. What I'm going to do is I'm going to show you that there is a reaction which truly involves a redox cycle as part of every turnover, not just to generate and degenerate the acidity. And I'm going to show you that as you evolve the surface structures in this range, there's also something very useful about those intermediate sites. If you look at the literature, this question continues to be asked, although there is significant evidence that as you increase the loading of vanadium oxide, there is what appears to be a higher catalytic activity that is more than the increase in the vanadium oxide. What is also true is that there's scattered data there that complicates the issue, and that every time you change the support, you appear to get different behavior. And I'd like to make an attempt at unifying this in some way by first complicating matters a great deal. What I'd like to do is I'd like to throw a bunch of supports. I'd like to throw a bunch of vanadium oxide contents on the sample. And I would like to use the concept of vanadium oxide surface density to show two things. First of all is that I'm covering a very wide range of vanadium oxide surface density. The other one is that the support does change the surface density because it has a different surface area. But I'm also going to show you that the support changes at a given value of surface density what the actual structures that you form there are, because obviously it depends on the vanadium oxide surface interaction, and that changes as you change the identity of that support. Well, what is known about this system is that you actually form rather orderly a monovanadate type species followed by densification into a polyvanadate and finally by the formation of bulk like V2O5. Well, I would like to show you first that two materials that have about the same surface density are going to give you a different set of surface structures. And I'd like to do that quite quickly without going into the details by using my favorite local structure technique, near-edge X-ray absorption spectroscopy. What I show here without your having to appreciate many of the details is effectively tetrahedral monovanadate type species, bulk like V2O5, and a set of vanadium on alumina catalyst with increasing surface density. What I have on the right hand side is the fraction of the vanadium plus 5, which I can calculate by fitting the near edge spectra to those two standard compounds on alumina and on silica. It is readily apparent that the fraction in tetrahedral centers increases with density. That's what you expect from densification, from the formation of polyvanadates at the expense of monovanadates. And the other thing is that at a given surface density, look, these two materials are very different. In other words, alumina is much more highly dispersed than silica. Silica looks an awful lot like V2O5. No great discovery here. Silica is known to be a very poor support for vanadium oxide. Now, if you look at the literature, you get this kind of a plot. And actually, if you look at my literature, you also get this kind of a plot. The point is that we all conclude that there are support effects on the rate of oxidative dehydrogenation of propane. When you look more closely, you begin to appreciate some of the finer details. First of all, for a given support, even though in this range of density, we have mostly dispersed vanadium oxide as either polyvanadate or monovanadate, there is an increase in the rate of the reaction per vanadium as I increase the surface density. When I look at various supports, I cannot really make much sense out of them, except that I point out the following. Here's vanadium on silica, very poorly dispersed. It has a low activity, obviously, because we have most of the vanadium buried in V2O5 type species. Here we have vanadium on alumina, the most highly dispersed among all the supported vanadium oxide that we have there, and it also has the lowest catalytic activity per vanadium. And these materials up here, which seem to have intermediate levels of dispersion by Raman spectroscopy, by X-ray absorption, by UV-Vis, I'm going to show you, the fact is they have the highest catalytic activity per vanadium atom. The materials that are neither isolated monovanadates or obviously bulk-like V2O5 are going to give you the highest apparent turnover rates, in this case, because most of the vanadia are being counted in the rate, but they're really not participating in the catalytic reaction. Well, we decided that we would borrow from the other project the ability of UV-visible band gap energies to tell us something about the level of dispersion, the domain size, on what appear to be, in most cases, polyvanadate type species. So what we did was we took the same set of samples that you saw the difficult to understand catalytic behavior, and we measured now the edge energy, this measure of qualitatively at least of the domain size of this polyvanadate species. And what we find is the following. Bulk V2O5 type behavior for for the case of silica, the most highly dispersed material is on aluminum oxide that is consistent with the Raman, and the other materials have sort of intermediate band gap energy, suggesting that their domain size is also intermediate. Notice that there is also a decrease in the band gap energy as I increase the loading. Again, it seems like as we densify species on that surface by crowding that surface, we get intermediate domain size and intermediate band gaps. The next step is going to be a bit of a leap of faith, and it's going to be an attempt not to give you a perfect correlation, but at least bring some sense into the data that I show you in the previous view graph. I cannot really tell very much from this plot, and nonetheless, it is very important, and it tells me quite a bit. What I would like to put here is somehow a measure of what is really changing in every one of the supports as I change the vanadium surface density. And what that's going to be is going to be the band gap energy. And I want to see if I can reproduce now for many supports the behavior that I know to be true for a single support, namely that there is a maximum and an intermediate surface density. I want to see if I can see the appearance of this volcano-type plots. Now let's take a moment to realize what a leap of faith this is, because it is effectively taking the two previous figures that I showed you, and rather than plotting each one of the data against the vanadium surface density, it's plotting each one of the data against each other. In effect, what we have here is the rate of propane oxidative dehydrogenation, the edge energy, with this here being isolated monovanadate type species, and this here being bulk-like V2O5. The remarkable part about the plot is, of course, this side, not this side. And what we see is, as we appear to increase the domain size, we decrease the band gap energy, for all the supports, we see what appears to be an increase in what is probably a turnover rate, because the rate is normalized per total vanadium, but on this side of the curve, most of the vanadia are exposed at the surface. The turnover rate, the rate per vanadium atom, is increasing as I make him larger and larger polyvanadate domains, and then if I continue, and I insist on continuing to do that, I begin to see a decrease which is due not to a lower surface activity for those large clusters, but to this disappearance of surface at the expense of the bulk. In other words, this side is due to the normal sintering, larger domains that we normally find in catalysis. This one appears to be an increase in intrinsic activity as we increase the domain size. It appears, and some of the propane reducibility and the hydrogen reducibility experiments that we have done, that the reason for this is similar to what we saw in tungsten oxide. The reducibility of tungsten centers is very, very poor for monovanadate type species, and it increases in rate as you increase the size of these domains. Now, if you really want to tell whether the activity, the surface activity, is really what we're measuring here, one simple experiment is to take bulk V2O5, measure its surface area, make some reasonable judgment about what fraction of that surface may be active, and then calculate a turnover rate. And the fact is that there is nothing wrong with V2O5 as a catalyst, except that it has a very low surface area. There is nothing wrong with vanadium oxide or silica as a catalyst. The problem is it has a very low surface area, because this line here would have continued to increase were it not for the fact that I'm beginning to now subtract surface size by placing them into the three-dimensional structures that begin to form past this point. I hope that I have made the connection between the two. In the first case, the redox properties gave rise to acidity, and then acidity took its course. And the fact is that intermediate cluster sizes were the optimum compromise between my ability to reduce, to make those reduced centers that give me the acidity, and my ability to expose them at the surface of one of these crystallites. For a reaction that has now every right to depend on the ability of vanadium oxide to be reduced and oxidized in order to complete a catalytic cycle, it looks like we get the same kind of behavior, the same kind of optimum balance between, again, my ability to reduce, which is impossible when I have isolated monovanadate or monotungstate species, and my ability to access the reduced centers, which becomes impossible to do as I get larger and larger clusters. Let me conclude, if that is necessary, because I just gave you the conclusion, and if you still don't see the connection between the two, please ask a question during the question and answer period. This here is not something that I really said. This is something that many people have said. And I guess the contribution here is in providing two examples, at least one of which is quite unusual in the fact that we have acid chemistry that is actually influenced by my ability to not only form domains of intermediate size, but to be able to form by a reduction the acid size that I need in order to be able to do the chemistry. This one, I guess if I had to summarize the contribution here, is to perhaps provide for a bit of consistency for what would otherwise be effectively scattered plots, for the observation that the rate of the reaction increases with vanadium loading on various supports, and the extent of increase depends on the support, because the role of the support is not just to place a certain vanadium oxide surface density, but to tell me what the structure is. And that changes not only with surface density, but with the strength of the interaction between the vanadium oxide and the support. Again, let me finish by acknowledging my co-authors, by acknowledging the National Science Foundation and this set of co-authors for the tungsten oxide work, by acknowledging the U.S. Department of Energy and these collaborators for the vanadium oxide part of the work. And thank you very much.
We have time for a couple of questions. Russ?
Can we have the lights in the front, please? Yeah.
Enrique, on the first part of the talk, where you had the volcano plot, and then you had color centers going sort of straight up there.
Right.
If you normalize out the situation due to the sintering, what happens to the turnover frequencies there? Do you plot it versus the color center or some other site?
No, you can't plot it versus the color centers anymore because some of them are actually in the bulk.
Okay,
so you cannot actually do that. There's still, the right-hand side of that curve is not very interesting catalytically, but there's still a question as to how much of that drop is due to surface area and how much of it is due to what we think is over-reduction. Actually, the beginnings of the removal of oxygen from the bulk that makes it now impossible to accommodate an additional negative charge in that cluster and therefore stabilize the proton. Those two things we cannot discern right now, but in any case, the right-hand side is catalytically not very interesting.
Yes?
Yeah, I think I was missing one thing about the tungsten species. Are you making just more acid sites, or are they stronger acid sites as you go up the range of collecting
sites? On the left-hand side, we appear to be forming more acid sites. And the hydrogen chemisorption data appears to tell us that. Also, the rate of formation of color centers is telling us that. It almost appears as if you're forming one hydrogen per tungsten cluster, and the more clusters you put in there, the larger the amount of hydrogen. But it appears from what we have seen so far, and again, those things are usually true within a factor of two or so, it appears as if all we're doing by reaching these intermediate size clusters is either increasing the number of sites or bringing sites that would otherwise have not been acidic enough into the right range of acidity. If you have hydrogen in the system, the hydrocarbon side of the chemistry appears to be, by all kinetic measurements, acid catalyzed protonation, methyl shift, deprotonation. The mechanism is not very similar, though very dissimilar from what you get in the zeolite. The problem is when you do the hydrocarbon chemistry in the absence of hydrogen. Nobody asks how come if I treat in helium and I run in helium, I still have a measurable reaction rate. The fact is that in that case, what you begin to use is the xylene as a sacrificial reagent. You actually do CH bond activation, you leave behind unsaturated aromatic species, and you produce a hydrogen. As you produce that hydrogen begins to desorb into the gas phase, and you need to sacrifice more and more xylene, leading to a fairly fast rate of deactivation. But the chemistry, it takes place on the hydrogen that you have formed in a sacrificial way from the xylene. And it resembles mechanistically, it is a monomolecular type reaction, it resembles mechanistically what everybody has known for a long time to be the mechanism for xylene isomerization. In the case of heptane, which I didn't talk about, it's a little bit different. In the case of heptane, These materials are able to hydrogen transfer into a carbocation using H2 from the gas phase, something that you cannot do in zeolites very readily. But that's a bit older, and I decided not to talk about that. But that chemistry is unique to these materials. The xylene isomerization is done.
Well, in order to keep with Pat's schedule, I guess we should move on to the next speaker and thank Enrique again.